Next on Enviro Close Up, the heightened impact of radiation on women and children. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman. With us is Cindy Folkers, and she's a specialist, an expert on the heightened, the increased impact of radiation on women and children. How are you, Cindy?
I'm fine today, Carl. Thank you.
What's the situation with radiation in women and children? It's worse than on men, apparently.
That is correct, Carl. And what's interesting is we have known, or at least the scientists have known, of the heightened impact of radiation on children pretty much since the end of the 1940s, which of course was the beginning of the bomb and nuclear power era. And at that point, they started to study surreptitiously the impact that they thought might be occurring for children in pregnancy. The heightened impact on women, however, wasn't necessarily suspected until a little bit later. And the data that we have on that come from the atomic bomb survivors, where they noticed in the data, or they recorded in the data, that there was an increase of about 50% more risk for cancer to women than men. And for little girls, the increase is about 10 times greater, the risk for cancer for little girls than it is for men. Now, that information on the gender differences of radioactivity didn't really happen, or wasn't really brought to the forefront until activists and independent experts noticed in a report from the National Academy of Sciences in 2006-2007 that these data were present in that report. But the people on the committee and the experts at the time didn't really bring this information out. And in fact, it took members not of their own community, i.e. the experts and the science and the scientists who are the officials, to bring this information to light. It took, like I said, activists and other independent experts to point this out. However, nothing has really happened with it since then. And we don't really understand, for children, we kind of understand why there might be heightened sensitivity to radioactivity. And the reason is because their cells are dividing more rapidly. Their bodies are growing, which means they need to pull in all the building block materials. So for instance, radioactive strontium 90, which is a radioactive isotope that comes from nuclear power and bomb tests, will collect in the bone matrix of children and developing fetuses greater concentrations than it will in the bodies of adults. And when a child or fetus is exposed to radioactive hydrogen, also known as tritium, which comes from nuclear power reactors, and carbon-14, which is also released routinely by nuclear power reactors, they collected in their tissue, fetal tissue, twice the concentration as does a female adult or maternal tissue. And so this is kind of common sense in that children are going to collect more of this material, therefore they're going to be exposed to more radioactivity because their bodies are growing and their cells are dividing quicker, which means that they could be more susceptible to incorrect cellular repair processes. But for women, it's much more open to debate as to why they seem to be more susceptible. It could be, we have now research showing that it could be estrogen, that radioactivity acts along the estrogenic pathway, and that the pathways for cancer of both estrogen and radioactivity could be comparable. But it could also be stem cells that women carry, or females in general, girls as well, carry more stem cells in their bodies than men do. And that could be a reason why they're more susceptible. And females of all ages are more susceptible to radioactivity, the same dose of radioactivity that their peers of the same age would be exposed to if the peers are men. So while we don't really know why it occurs, we know that it is present in the data sets. And we also historically haven't really done the research to figure out why. So, you know, we haven't researched estrogen like we should be. We haven't researched, we just started to look at the stem cell issue. And the estrogen question has been around probably at least since 2011. And as far as I know, as a medical hypothesis, it really hasn't been followed up on.
Some of the consequences of this increased or heightened impact of radiation on women and children.
So we see what happens in areas of just above natural background radiation, that we have increases of childhood cancers, particularly leukemias and central nervous system cancers. And this is in areas that are heightened both with natural background radioactivity, but also in areas that have contamination from cesium-137, let's say, which is a radionuclide that came from Chernobyl. So some of these studies are in Europe that show this. But in addition to the cancer question, we have studies that show from the Nordic countries that just being in just above background while you're pregnant, having a pregnancy in just above background radiation levels can lead to a decrease in ability to perform in school, increase in neuro damage, so your brain doesn't quite function like it should, a decrease in IQ, a decrease in executive functions. And all of this happens, we believe, during pregnancy, exposure to radioactivity, and then you end up not being able to be your fully functioning self. It can impact your economic prospects. Your ability to earn a living can decrease. So these aren't just health impacts, they're full life stage impacts for your entire life. And for instance, in the areas where we see neural development impact, we also notice the underperformance in school is mainly in math and science. And so we begin to see a pattern of not just clinical impact of cancer, because you can diagnose a cancer, right? But a subclinical, what's called a subclinical impact of radiation exposure. And that's for, well, that's for pregnancy. For women, we have data on cancer, but we don't really have data on other impacts, except as they are women exposed as children.
Now, why has this heightened impact been downplayed by folks responsible for, in fact, analyzing the consequences of radioactivity?
Well, you know, it's interesting because if you look at the historical documents, in 1959, Eisenhower created, through executive order, something called the Federal Radiation Council. And the Federal Radiation Council wrote a few reports in the 60s. It was subsumed into the EPA later when the EPA was formed. But its initial reports in the early years, the early 60s, mentioned a few things that we should really examine fully today. For instance, they entertained the possibility, mentioned, didn't do anything with it, but they mentioned the possibility of a standard child, which would have been something that regulatory bodies would have taken in order to use for radiation protection for members of the public, children who would be exposed to radioactivity. So that's one of the things that they mentioned. They mentioned it in one report, and it is silent on standard child. In subsequent reports, they don't mention it. So they go radio silent on standard child. And who takes center stage but standard man, later to be called reference man, on which, the model of which, all our standards are pretty much based today. So that was the first thing in these early reports. The second thing in these early reports that the FRC, this council, put out, really recognized that it was almost inevitable that there would be genetic impact from radiation exposure. But they didn't do what was necessary at the time to either investigate that further or to take the steps needed to fully protect for those impacts. And instead, on the contrary, what they did was they introduced other factors in considering whether or not they should carry forward nuclear technology after World War II. And the factors that they would consider would be economic, they would be societal, they would be, you know, what are the benefits to the world? And of course, underlying all of this was national security. So they interjected this risk-based analysis into what should have been really primarily a health question. And in fact, after Fukushima began, there was a UN Human Rights Committee travel trip to Japan to examine what was going on with Fukushima and how they were handling the aftermath, and specifically with regard to women and children, how they were handling their exposures and their resettlement and all of that. And one of the conclusions that this report came to was that the risk-based analysis was not compatible with the right to human health. And so it's interesting that in the early 1960s, we see all of these potential pitfalls. And the third one I will mention is that they said that there were co-carcinogens with radiation that they mentioned in the early 60s in these reports. And those co-carcinogens were other chemicals, hormones, and viruses. But the research to look into that co-carcinogenic quality, it just wasn't done. It wasn't funded. And the independent research that was done in the day that showed increased sensitivity of pregnancy and increased potential genetic damage, the scientists that turned out that independent research, they were bullied, they were silenced, their careers were ruined, they were defunded. And it was a whole attempt to make the real questions of radiation exposure the ones that would actually matter and the ones that would point to these disproportionate impacts more fully rather than the bunch of uncertainty that we have now, they were discounted.
Now, Cindy, you're the radiation and health specialist at the organization Beyond Nuclear. You give presentations, you have for years, on these issues that you're addressing on our program today. You've also written, and I have in terms of journal publication, here is one just a few months ago, in the Journal of the History of Biology, titled Disproportionate Impact of Radiation Exposure on Women, Children. You're trying to get the word out, but in general, this information that you're trying to convey has, not been conveyed by the scientific establishment. Am I correct?
It has not been the forefront of the research efforts that need to happen. And it has also not been, when it has been discovered, like the instance that I gave, the example that I gave with the women's data from the atomic bomb survivors, the NAS panel and that expert panel, they mentioned it in the report, but they don't elevate it to the level that it needed to be elevated to. So it's there, it's in the research, but the problem is they don't really research it like they should, they don't really fund it like they should, and as a result, it doesn't get out to the public like it should. And the science that comes through in the studies, when they see these impacts on children, they see these impacts on pregnancy and childhood leukemias and central nervous system cancers, they always try to say, or almost always, try to attribute it to a source other than radioactivity, even if they don't name that source, because they can say that the doses are too low. But in fact, the doses may not be too low. It just may be that there is no threshold for damage. And in fact, that is recognized, that there is no threshold or no radiation dose below which there will not be a health impact, particularly for pregnancy, particularly for fetal development. A single hit could take out the cell that's meant to develop into a brain. So we have a circumstance in which women have been marginalized, their concerns have been marginalized, and since they are often the ones that speak up for their children in areas that are contaminated and areas where they may have to live or eat contaminated food from, they raise these issues and they are often told that, you know, they shouldn't worry their pretty little heads about it, that they're radiophobic, that they're worrying needlessly, et cetera, et cetera. And we've seen a history, not just of tamping down the independent science that demonstrates disproportionate impacts, but we have seen a history of attacking the very women and that are going through these lived experiences and having their experiences not only discounted, but told that they're mentally ill.
Wow. Now, you've proposed that this reference man basis for radiation exposure be altered, and they should be, instead of just reference man, reference woman, reference girl, and so forth. Can you amplify on that?
Sure. The first caveat I will say is that reference girl is great. We would need a reference girl standard, and I will explain what that is in the context of what we have, which is reference man. But she is only the beginning. She's not the end point. Really, what we need is a reference fetus, because that's really where the generational damage is done. Consider, for instance, that a female fetus creates all of the eggs she will ever have when she's in her mother's womb. And so we are talking about the third generation, the granddaughter generation, that if that fetus is exposed, could be impacted, male or female. So really we need a reference fetus, but reference girl is good, and she's going to be easy to slot into the current formulas that are used to determine radiation damage that we have at the regulatory level. Currently they're based on reference man, 150 pound, 25 to 30 year old individual, about 5'7", Western European in culture and habit. And of course, a lot of the people that are exposed to radioactivity, especially the environmental contamination, they don't fit that profile at all. Consider the uranium miners, okay, and their families, right? So we would, in consultation with impacted communities, develop a reference girl who would replace reference man. We slot her in, so where the 8 parameters of the reference man are now in the regulations, we would slot her 8 parameters in there. So if you're a 150-pound man, maybe you're a 40-pound girl, right? And that's what we would do, and that would be the idea. And this idea is actually Mary Olson's conception. She is with Gender Radiation Impact Project. She conceived of reference girl, and then she came to me and asked me to collaborate with her on this project because of my work with disproportionate impacts, particularly fetal impacts. And so we make a good team because we go into this with eyes open, right? Reference girl won't be the end. We say that up front, but she's going to be 10 times more protective than a reference man is. So that's good. That's good. And she's going to be easy to put into the regulations, the regulatory scheme.
How do you see this issue of radiation impacts fitting into the push that is going on these days? The claim that nuclear power is necessary to deal with climate change.
Right. So the climate crisis has to be addressed, no question. There are better ways to address it than with nuclear power. We have a handle, at least in part, on the economics of nuclear power, the fact that we don't have anything to do with the waste, and we can't get rid of the waste, that we're having to deal with, let me put it this way, nuclear power, we're gonna be done with nuclear power a long time before nuclear power is done with us, okay? But this is part of the problem. In all of this mix, we are not considering the disproportionate impacts to women, children, and pregnancy. We're not doing it. And in order to make decisions on what energy sources we need to address the climate crisis, but also to handle the contamination, the nuclear contamination that we already have, we are going to have to adjudicate how the disproportionate impacts affect society, our life cycle as human beings, which reference man doesn't do, and how radiation impacts all of that. We need to account for the disproportionate impacts, not just to make decisions for energy use for the climate crisis and what renewable energies we're going to use to address that, but how we are going to handle our lasting nuclear contamination legacy.
Human rights issues. You've written about these issues figuring into this very important issue.
Yes. So it was a long time in coming. It did not happen after Chernobyl, but it happened after Fukushima. The Human Rights Committee, at the invitation of the Japanese government, went into Fukushima and they assessed how, as I stated before, the Japanese government was handling the radiation contamination and the relocation and the psychological stress. And there is psychological stress after a disaster, no question. in the populations in Fukushima, particularly with regard to women and kids. And they found that the government of Japan should not be increasing the limits 20 times exposure to radiation, 20 times greater than before the catastrophe in Fukushima. The report reasoned, well, if one millisievert, which is the measure of radiation exposure and damage, was good enough before the accident, it's good enough for after the catastrophe, and you shouldn't be raising it to 20, which the Japanese government did. And now we have a court decision out of Japan that says that 20 millisieverts is perfectly fine because the people who are in those contaminated areas were never promised that they would have one millisievert a year of exposure. So now you've got the Japanese courts backing up the 20 millisievert limit, which by the way is absolutely ridiculous. You will see all kinds of health impacts if that is allowed to go forward, and that's the actual dose that people get. And so it's extremely important that the human rights committees keep revisiting the Fukushima issue, because they've been there at least once, probably twice since their initial report. And their follow-up reports are not seeing any improvement in how Japan has been handling the accident or the exposures. So it's really important that the UN Human Rights Commission, particularly with regard to health, particularly with the frameworks on the rights of a child and the rights of women, go into these areas. And I would love to see the same thing happen in the Chernobyl contaminated areas. Even this number of decades later, you still need to take account of the human rights violations. And so looking at the report that was put out by the Human Rights Commission and the way that they handle the risk-based analysis and the way that they handle the dose levels, the government in Japan, it really raises the question that needs to continue to be asked. Can nuclear power, even under normal operating circumstances, comport with the right to human health?
Now, you've also written and spoken about conflict of interest in regard to this downplaying of the heightened impact of radioactivity on women and children.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and I actually want to start this out by saying, in the regulations right now, we have something called a permissible dose. But if you trace that back in the history of radiation exposure, you see that it was actually called an acceptable injury limit to start with. So all along, they knew that it would be injurious to have any sort of exposure to radioactivity. That was in the science from the beginning. The reason that I bring this up is because that is part of the basis, along with the risk-based analysis and all of this other stuff, all of these other parameters that they add in addition to health, that makes the science of radiation study very much beholden to the people who support nuclear technology. And I mean nuclear power, I mean nuclear weapons, and to a certain extent, nuclear medicine as well. So it's important to remember that the very people at the beginning, and this has not changed through the decades, at the beginning of the nuclear age, which I am counting at the bomb part, we had radium dial painters earlier, but I'm going to start this at late 40s. The people at the beginning set the system up to make it more palatable to the public. And they did so by trying to downplay the human health impact. And in doing so, the very people who were responsible for the exposures were also the people who were adjudicating what it meant to get those exposures. Were you getting sick? Oh, no, you don't have to worry about that. So the people who set up the exposures are also the ones who became the people who decided how you evaluate those exposures. So this conflict of interest, even though it's more egregious in some studies than it is in others, was set up like that from the very beginning.
Just with a few minutes left, can you discuss the organization that you've been a staff member of, Beyond Nuclear, based in Tacoma Park, Maryland, near Washington, D.C.?
Well, the short mission statement for Beyond Nuclear is we work for a world free of nuclear weapons and nuclear power. And in order to do that, of course, there's a lot of detail there. We have great people on staff. We work a lot with First Nations. and expose other exposed communities to try and pull out what is most important to those communities and how we can put pressure on not only governments to try and get them to understand exactly how important it is that we have the right energy sources and that we not only have the proper energy sources to address the climate crisis, but that we also have an accounting of what happened with the past, with this particular technology, nuclear tech, because we need to make sure that this kind of decision doesn't happen again, that we are not going to be subjected. Because like I said, nuclear power, we may be finished with it. So even if we stop using it and stop using it tomorrow, it's not going to be finished with us. We are going to have a legacy of waste, a legacy of exposures, a legacy of contamination worldwide that we're going to have to deal with, both from weapons and from power.
How can people support Beyond Nuclear? How can they connect to Beyond Nuclear and read about, learn more about your issues and the other issues that Beyond Nuclear is tackling?
So we have a website for the main organization, which is www.beyondnuclear.org. Then we also have a Beyond Nuclear International website, which talks about and features the stories of people in exposed communities and the people who are working to bring all of these issues to light, including the disproportionate impacts. You can go to either site. Please feel free to tool around any of the sites and get information. The beyondnuclear.org site is more detail oriented and more scientific in some ways. The Beyond Nuclear International site is again story focused for stories of people who have lived these radiation experiences. They can sign up for the Beyond Nuclear International weekly digest. They can sign up for the Beyond Nuclear International, the Beyond Nuclear Bulletin. So there's two. One is more action-oriented. That's the Beyond Nuclear Bulletin. And the other, again, is story-oriented, and that's Beyond Nuclear International.
And just let me ask, how did you personally get into the radiation and health issue?
Well, it was nothing personal to me, except that I will say that I have... I found the radiation issue compelling because it was so obvious to me that there were issues there that needed uncovering and that it was a human rights issue from the beginning. And I have a very acute sense of what's right and what's wrong. And if I feel that something's wrong, I can't really let it continue. So, it's an innate sense of justice, I guess.
Thank you, Cindy Focus, for your such important work. Thank you so much for being with us on Enviro Close Up. Again, viewers, please go to the website of Beyond Nuclear to learn more, and go to our website, envirovideo.com, to see. We've been doing these programs now for 30 years. Watch other programs on critical environmental issues, including issues involving the dangers of nuclear technology. I'm Carl Grossman. Thank you for watching.